Did you know that the ancient Egyptians used actual computers to design and build the pyramids? It's true. Apparently, they were a gift from the aliens. Okay, that part's not true. But computers were used. Though, actually, we're catching you on a technicality. The word computer was first used to describe a human job, not an electronic machine. Human computers have been used for millennia to perform math by hand. For example, calculating the location of a ship based on the stars. These computers took input data, processed it according to instructions, and produced an output. This is the basic process we still call computing. Now fast forward to the 1940s. Suddenly, electronic machines were capable of doing this type of computing. An early example was the ENIAC, the Electronic Numeral Integrator and Computer, built by the U.S. military to calculate missile trajectories. The ENIAC was faster at computing than anyone or anything before it. In its 10 years of operation, it performed more calculations than all humans collectively had ever done before. But it was massive, weighing 30 tons, and it wasn't very versatile. Input data had to be fed to the machine via punch cards, and instructions for the calculations had to be manually configured via switches and plug boards. Want to do a different calculation? Reconfigure the switches. So, while this monster computer was workable for the military, it wasn't so appealing to other users, like businesses. Several innovations changed that. Among these innovations were solutions for more permanent storage, the hard drive being the real breakthrough. Storage is the second critical task accomplished by modern computers, in addition to the computing itself. Enhanced storage meant that computing instructions could be saved on the device itself and more easily adjusted. In short, these computers were more programmable and therefore easier to apply to a variety of tasks. This laid the foundation for modern software. Businesses were suddenly taking note, looking to make use of these computing machines for calculation-intensive tasks like keeping track of inventory or calculating payroll. By the 1980s, further advances led to smaller internal components, and suddenly much smaller computers were viable, personal computers, or PCs. Businesses soon began buying PCs for their employees. Before long, all these computers could be connected together in a sort of web, both via a local web within the company and via the public World Wide Web, the Internet. These webs made something else possible, the splitting up of the various computing and storage tasks across different connected devices. Dedicated central computers could now handle certain intensive tasks like managing vast new databases, and smaller PCs could take less intensive tasks like word processing. This led to a new computing architecture altogether, where companies maintained so-called data centers capable of storing the bulk of the data and performing the bulk of the computation. Today, the data center is the heart of any enterprise IT environment. Sometimes companies have their own data centers on premises, and sometimes they rent access to a third-party data center via the internet. This is cloud computing. In this primer, we focus on all the key hardware in the enterprise IT ecosystem, the data center equipment, and end-user devices like PCs, which have more in common than you might think. We'll explore each of these hardware types, how they get made and sold, the key players involved, and the latest trends.